What is the molecular formula of aluminium sulfide?
K4YM3.
Correct. What was Kiri Kintar's first law of metaphysics?
Nothing unreal exists.
Correct. Adjust the sine wave of this magnetic envelope so that antineutrons can pass through it, but antigravitons cannot. Solve.
White queen to section 5, grid 6.
Correct.
Queen takes knight. Rook takes queen. White pawn to section 5, grid 7. Pawn takes rook. Checkmate.
Correct. Name the highest grossing Star Trek movie to date.
J.J. Abrams, Star Trek 2009.
Really?
Yeah.
How do you feel?
Huh?
How do you feel?
Oh. Peachy.
Disclaimer. The following Star Trek review is of Jeffrey Jacobs' 2009 franchise reboot, and nothing else. The author wishes to emphasize the point that she is not a colossal nerd.
I'm not! When I first heard about this film, I was doubtful. I mean, come on, a prequel thing? Yeah, because that's worked out so well for science fiction recently. And it didn't help that I was already half confused to death by those strange promos declaring that this is not your father's Star Trek. Not your father's Star Trek? What, you mean the good Star Trek that everyone loves? Huh? Oh, wait, they must be referring to those silly TNG movies that kind of ruined the franchise. But that only ended in 2002. I suppose they could be your father's Star Trek if you were, like, 9. Oh, balls, that's who this movie's marketed at, isn't it? 9-year-olds. But hang on, it's by the Lost guy. And hey, is that Spock? Like, the real Spock in there? Holy shorts, Leonard Nimoy! He's a quality actor producer. He just wouldn't be in a bad Trek, right? Right? Shut up, that doesn't count! Suffice it to say that I went into this thing with absolutely no expectations. Well, none that didn't involve the special effects. So it seems some Maori Romulans have showed up from the future in some way that hasn't been explained yet. And get used to that. And there's Captain Kirk. Oh wait, no, it's not Captain Kirk. It's Captain Kirk's daddy who's in a snit because his captain's just been kidnapped by the Incredible Hulk.
And he looks angry.
For some reason, he wants Ambassador Spock. But nobody knows who Spock is.
Dum dum dum.
Yet Captain Commander Kirk can't quite care about that right now because he's got to ram his ship into the baddies. Though not before he's evacuated all the red shirts. Including his pregnant wife who's about to give birth to one infant James T. Okay, stop the movie. You're just gonna kill off Captain Kirk's father at his birth? Okay, well this isn't Captain Kirk anymore. Not our Captain Kirk at any rate. I mean, at his birth?
Captain Kirk! I'm Captain Kirk!
No, he's a completely different person. Who steals cars and gets into bar fights.
Truly the stuff of legend!
Remember that episode of TNT when Captain Xavier went back in time and screwed over his entire life just by altering the outcome of a fight? I mean, butterfly effects and causality and stuff, dude! It's as a wise old man once sagely said.
If you ever travel back in time, don't step on anything, because even the tiniest change can alter the future in ways you can't imagine!
Testify! Anyway, cut forward in time to the impetuousness of youth, as young James is now shaping up to be a galaxy-class buttock. It makes me wonder why modern-day Hollywood always seems to portray its heroic figures as a product of juvenile delinquency. Are you an irritating pimple on the tongue of creation? Great! You're headed for big things! I mean, just contrast this with the classic story of young James Kirk, where by age 13 he was already off-world and witnessing the life-changing horrors of the Kodos Holocaust. Not only was he not a douche, but this was also a far more compelling origin story for Kirk that the writers could easily have told if they bothered to do just a little more research into the character that... I'm not a nerd! So meanwhile on Vulcan, young Spock's having a bad day. It seems some kids are picking on him because he's different. And Spock decides to let his old buddies live long and prosper, do the talking. Now, I could get all kinds of loud over this depiction of the Vulcans. These aliens are supposed to be logical creatures, right? Yet here we see them emotional, condescending, and violent. But you know what? I really don't mind. Spock is half-human after all, and some of these things were actually hinted at in the original series. Shame we never saw Spock's teddy bear.
A teddy bear?
But it's a darn sight better than how the Vulcans were portrayed in the last 4 series of Trek.
Well, Vulcans do have the same basic emotions we do. They've just learned to repress them.
I refuse to engage in this human game of taunting.
Human? Did I forget to wear my spots today?
All that intelligence and he still doesn't know what a human looks like. I refuse to deny myself passion the way you and men like my father do.
You reject logic.
If I was meant to deny feelings, why was I born with them?
This seems as good a time as any to get started.
Listen to me, you're making a mistake.
When your logic doesn't work, you raise your voice. You've been on Earth too long.
Compared to that, the Vulcans in this movie are actually... Wait, is that Winona Ryder in there? Huh? Oh, I see what you did there. So, anyway, Spock turns out to be such a super genius that he decides to give the Vulcan Council the finger. And the index finger, and the little finger, and the thumb, and the...
Get on with it!
Yes! Get over with it!
Sorry. And he ends up joining Starfleet, where he quickly declares himself king. Because he's in charge of everything! He's 26, why is he in charge of everything? He's like a year older than Kirk! And we see Kirk doing his final exam! So even if it took Kirk longer to join Starfleet in this universe, Spock would still only be like an ensign or something, right? Why is an ensign running Starfleet? Okay, so maybe he isn't running it, but he seems to be in charge of a whole bunch, and he's there when Kirk's doing his thing in the Kobayashi Maru simulator that... Wait, what?
How the hell did that kid beat your test?
I do not know.
No. No. No, 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 no! No! Spock did not write the Kobayashi Maru. We know it. We know it because...
I never took the Kobayashi Maru test. Until now. What do you think of my solution?
He never took the test he wrote. What kind of super-duper alien programmer genius designs a complicated system of analysis without ever personally testing it? Not even the Almighty himself begrudges a little quality control. If Spock, that diligent, egoless logic machine, designed the Kobayashi Maru, he would have been the first person to take it, which means one of two things. Either this movie is making Spock out to be a complete idiot, or it's trying to retcon Wrath of Khan. And let me tell you, you do not mess with Wrath of Khan! Meanwhile, young James is hanging around a bar trying very hard to pick up a certain Na'vi princess. This ends badly as young Jim's smooth moves bounce right into some of Starfleet's brightest. Young James fails at fighting and is about to have his face handed to him when in walks Captain Christopher Pike.
It's been a long road. Getting from
I'm not sure why Pike shows up at that exact moment. But Pike likes Kirk, you see, and...
But my time is finally...
No.
I can feel a change in the wind.
I mean, he just likes Kirk.
Nothing's in my way.
I mean, he admires him because
I'm not gonna hold me down no more. No, they're not gonna hold me down. Cause I've got faith on the heart.
He stops the fight, okay? He just stops the fight. Sheesh. And he tells Kirk to join Starfleet. Kirk says no, but then joins anyway. And it's here we meet Dr. Leonard McCoy. Hooray! Something in this movie I like! Not only does Carl Urban nail the part, but he's also better looking than Kirk? Awesome!
I've got nowhere else to go. The ex-wife took the whole damn planet in the divorce. All I got left is my bones.
And that booze. Don't forget the booze. I feel the nickname coming on. But lo, at that moment, the bad guy is somewhere, doing something.
Sir. We've arrived at the coordinates you calculated.
There's nothing here.
What are your orders?
We wait. We wait for the one who allowed our home to be destroyed. As we've been doing for 25 years. Welcome back, Spock.
He's doing the what now? Oh, I get it. He's mad at Spock. Why?
We wait for the one who allowed our home to be destroyed.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch, we see Kirk, studying? But for what? Why, the coolest thing ever! The Kobayashi Maru test. Now, I've been wanting to see this for years. Remember in Wrath of Khan, where Kirk sort of hints at his sophisticated manipulation of the test that had everyone scratching their heads for days, going, "You cheeky little rogue, never doing it."
He cheated.
I changed the conditions of the test. Got a commendation for original thinking.
Well, now we'll get to see it. Let's watch.
Yeah.
to push up to see.
What is this? What's going on?
Fire on all enemy ships.
What the fuck?
Guten Tag.
Subtle. Naturally, a level of cheatage this leet makes Spocktoe totally hysterical, so he has himself a little trial to calm his nerves.
This is Commander Spock. He is one of our most distinguished graduates. He's programmed the Kobayashi Maru exam for the last 4 years.
He's been doing the thing for 4 years. He would have only just graduated when that began. Give me a break. No, I've covered this already. Con!
I don't think you like the fact that I beat your test.
Furthermore, you have failed to divine the purpose of the test.
Enlighten me again.
The purpose is to experience fear. Fear in the face of certain death.
It's not a test of fear, you jackass. It's a test of critical thinking in a no-win situation. The fear test is an entrance exam. Wesley Crusher took it in TNG episode 119, Coming of Age, where a simulated... anyway. Before anyone can ask how the emotionless half-falcon is able to write a test that can scare humans...
War were declared.
So it seems that every single vessel in the Federation is out to lunch, except for most of them, including the flagship. And Starfleet sends in no less than the C-Team. Kirk's still suspended, but Boone sneaks him on board using some drugs that make his hands go all funny. And it's here we discover that everyone in the universe outranks Cadet James Kirk, including Lieutenant Commander Spock, Lieutenant Uhura, Ensign Sulu, and Ensign Chekov? Huh? Isn't Chekov maybe 12 years younger than Kirk? He'd be like 13! Why is he in some movie? Anyway, they all head off for Vulcan. You'd get delayed when Sulu ass-farts around with the controls for a bit. But that gives him time to intercept a communique from the battlefront. Turns out there's a big lightning storm in space over Vulcan. And when Kirk hears about it, he goes right loopy and runs up to the bridge. He tells Captain Pike that a lightning storm in space can mean only one thing.
It's a trap!
Zachary Spocktoe agrees. So Captain Pike decides that instead of blundering right into a trap...
Shields up. Red alert.
They'll blunder right into a trap with their shields up. Oop, watch out for the SF debris!
Ow! The shields! They do nothing!
So, of course, they end up with the bad guy right in their grill and... Oh, gosh, that's beautiful. You know, I complain, but dang if this movie isn't gorgeous. Wait a minute. A lightning storm in space? Doesn't a lightning storm in space mean a black wormhole thingy? Did someone travel through time? What? Bueller? Can I get some service here?
Hello.
Oop, who's this?
I'm Captain Christopher Pike. To whom am I speaking?
Hi, Christopher. I'm Nero.
And I'll be your waiter. Can I interest you in the specials? After mentioning that he's not with the Romulan Empire, the incredible Nero informs them that the Enterprise is boned. They can't use the phones or transport anywhere, because they're being blocked by Nero's pulsating dongly thing.
It's a big drill.
He then says that Captain Pike has to come over in a shuttlecraft by himself for... negotiations. Dum dum dum. Okay, this is bad. They're outgunned and out of time. And whatever Nero's ship is doing to the planet can't be good. What'll they do? Well, let's lay out their options. Number one. Shoot and disable the drill apparatus with a concentrated volley of photon torpedoes and phaser fire, thus rescuing the planet and re-establishing communications. Number two, outfit Captain Pike's shuttlecraft with high-yield explosives instead of Captain's. Or number three,
sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows. Everything that's wonderful is what I feel when